Okay, so welcome to calculus. So last time we were talking about separable differential equations, and we mentioned one differential equation, and we noted that it wasn't separable. So specifically, the example that we did was we said, okay, we have x dy dx plus 6y plus 2x to 4 is 0. And the instruction was to find the general solution, which means go all the way up to the plus c, but you don't have to figure out what plus c is, what the c is. The question we asked was, is this separable? Which means that can you get all the x's and dx's on one side and all the y's and dy's on the other side? And the answer is no, this is not separable. Nevertheless, we were able to sort of magically pull something out of a hat. Yeah. So let's see how we did that. So just to remind you of the way it went. So we said, okay, for some reason I'm going to divide by x. So divide by x. And then now I'm going to take all the terms that have y and leave them on the left, and all of the terms that do not have y and move them to the right. And then, through some mystery process, I said, I think it would be a great idea to multiply both sides by x to 6. And it was a little bit mysterious as to why and where the x to 6 came from. But when you do that, then you have x to 6 dy dx plus 6x to 5 y is negative 2x to 9. And then notably, this left-hand side is the sum of two terms. And each term is the product of two factors. And this can be understood as being what? A product rule. A product rule. In particular, it is always going to be. So the question is, the thing that I want to point out is that it's going to turn out to be a product rule. And the question is what goes in there? So it is x to 6. Let me erase that. I'm going to write it in red. X to 6, y. So this magic x to 6 allowed us to get to this position. So notice that when you take y to be a function of x, an implicit function of x, and you're going to compute the derivative, then you'll use the product rule. So it'll be this times the derivative of y, so that's that term, plus the derivative of x to 6, which is 6x to 5, times y. So what the purpose of this x to 6 was to make this happen. Okay, now I haven't described how I came up with x to 6, but that was the purpose of using x to 6. So now I'm going to take this dx and I'm going to move it to the other side. And now, formerly, all of the differential equations that we solved were separable, which means that we could get all the x's and dx's on one side and all the y's and dy's on the other side. This differential equation did not have that property. Nevertheless, using this magic x to 6, we were able to make this separation. We separated in this way. We got all the differentials separated on two different sides like this now. So what can we do from here? We can now anti-differentiate. Okay, the right-hand side is easy, so I'll just do it without asking. But the left-hand side, until you get accustomed to looking at it, is a little disturbing. So what is the left-hand side?
The left-hand side?
What, yeah.
X to the 6y?
X to 6y. Because the antiderivative and differential cancel. So you are left with only x to 6y. Now, if this was t, what's antiderivative of dt? T. What's antiderivative of dq?
Q.
What's antiderivative of d pinky?
Pinky.
Pinky, right? Whatever's under my pinky. So antiderivative of d x to 6y is just x to 6y. And then this is an antiderivative you could have done a month ago. So this is negative 1/5 x to 10 plus a constant. And then you can divide by, you know, if the problem asked you to solve for y explicitly, then you could say, well, this is negative 1/5 x to 4 plus c over x to 6. Okay. Any question about this one? So now what we have to do is we have to figure out, okay, what are we going to do if the x to 6 is not given to us? How do we figure it out for ourselves? So is that your question?
I was actually just going to ask you about the c. Do you have to write it as c over x to the 6, or can you just write it as c?
You have to write it as c over x to 6.
Okay.
Because this is an arbitrary constant, but now it's a function. It's a constant it's an arbitrary constant divided by a function.
Got it.
Other questions? Okay. So, here's the definition. This is called a linear first order differential equation. So it's any equation that can be expressed in this form, dy dx plus p of x times y is q of x. Okay, so I'd like to point out that the previous exercise that we worked on, the one on the previous page, can be written in that way. So in the previous exercise, what is p of x? So comparing terms, right? Comparing terms. dy dx, there's y, so what's p of x? 6 over x. And what's q? Negative 2x cubed. So the one that we were working on previously is one of these things. It's one of these. So a linear first order differential equation. Okay. So, here's a proposition. What we want to do is we want to take dy dx plus P of X Y is Q of X. We want to take this and we want to multiply by some function I of X. Some function I of X. And on the previous exercise, this was X to 6. We want to multiply by I of X. So we'll do that. So I of X dy dx plus I of X P of X Y is I of X Q of X. And then what was the trick that we ended up using last time? What were we trying to force to happen?
Oh,
to make the product rule work. So we want to multiply by I of X, and the I of X that we choose has to be such that the derivative of I of X times Y, which is I of X dy of X plus the derivative of I of X Y is this. Okay, so now let's compare terms. So notice that this is the product rule. So this term right here is automatically right. So these ones agree. Okay, so they're already in agreement. So what are the things that we really need to match? That needs to match up right?
I'm fine.
Yeah. What we really need is we really need I prime of X to be I of X, P of X. That's what we really need. This is the important part. So if we could somehow find an I of X that would do that, then we would win, right? If we can get that to work. And so therefore, what we need I prime of X to be I of X, P of X. And what we want to do now is we want to solve this equation. Solve this for I of X. Okay. So let's solve this for I of X. Well, we can get I of X, the derivative of I over I is P of X. So I divided both sides by I of X. So now I'll anti-differentiate both sides. And so now here's the trick. The left-hand side, you actually can anti-differentiate it. How do you anti-differentiate the left-hand side? So look at it. Look at the form that it's in. It's in the form U prime over U, isn't it? Not by parts. You could do a substitution. If you say u is the denominator, u is I, then du is I prime dx. So this is in the form 1 over u du. What is the antiderivative of 1 over u du?
Log
absolute value. So we have that the log of the absolute value of I of x is the antiderivative of p of x dx. So we need to get I by itself. So how do we get it outside of log? Yeah, we need to exponentiate both sides. So the absolute value of I of x is exponential of antiderivative of p of x.
What? You can put antiderivative, okay. Hold on, I'm sorry.
Okay. All right. So then now, that means if we drop the absolute value, this is plus or minus exponential of antiderivative of p of x. We're almost to the end. Okay, now, so that means that I of x could be either one of these. But we only need one of them, right? We only need any I that would do it. So that means that we'll choose, one I of x. So we'll select I of x is exponential of antiderivative of p of x. And now this is a formula that you must memorize. So you don't need to memorize the way we came up with that. You don't need to memorize why this is the case. But you do need to memorize this formula.
As long as I have the formula, will I be good, or am I going to have to solve the formula?
Okay, so more or less, as long as you have the formula, you'll be good, I think.
You're halfway there.
Yeah.
I just got along with paintball.
So in the end, all you have to do is this.
Oh, yeah.
So all this stuff.
That doesn't look difficult.
Great,
at all.
No problem at all.
This here is called an integrating factor, which is why it's called I.
And this is how you find the x to the sixth that we.
This is how you find x to six.
Okay.
Question.
Yes.
Over here.
Yes.
Okay. Question is: does this apply to all cases? Positive e to the antiderivative of x dx, or just all the cases we're going to deal with? I mean, is there ever going to be
no. Any I will work. And the reason why is because if you look at this equation, if I was negative, then its derivative would still be negative and they'd cancel. So in fact, you could take any constant multiple of this, any non-zero multiple of this, and it'd be fine. But because you could do, you could put a 7 in there. But because any of that would work, why not just choose 1? There it is. I think that might be a drill motor.
Yeah.
It could be. Okay, well, at any rate, integrating factor. So now let's look at that previous exercise that we did, and let's pretend for a minute that we've forgotten that x to 6 was the magic piece. And so that exercise was dy dx plus 6 over x y is -2 x cubed. I wonder if that's getting picked up on the camera. Otherwise, it's going to be just, you'll hear me chuckling for no apparent reason. Okay, so what we're using is that dy dx plus p of x y equal to q of x. So this is called a linear first order differential equation. And what we're going to use is the integrating factor I of x is exponential of antiderivative of p of x. Okay. So, I have a question for you. In this exercise, what is what is p of x?
6 over x.
Just 6 over x. So this is p over x. P of x is what I'm trying to say. And then what is q of x?
-2.
Right, this part.
Yeah, something tells me their deadline will allow them to.
Okay, so then the integrating factor is I of x equal to exponential of antiderivative of 6 over x dx.
Calculator?
No.
It was a good thought.
So, what's the antiderivative of 6 over x? Log absolute x, right? So this would be exponential, and then 6 log absolute x. And then we do not need a plus c at this juncture. Okay, now, we used x to 6, so allegedly this is x to 6. Let's see if we can get it to be x to 6. What can we do with this 6, according to the log rules? It can come inside of the log, right? So this would be exponential of log of absolute value of x to 6. Like that. And then how do the exponential and the log interact? They cancel. So that this is absolute value of x to 6. But then we can drop the absolute value. Why can we drop the absolute value?
It doesn't matter. Plus or minus, not important.
So why can we drop that absolute value?
Because
the exponent is even.
Oh.
X to 6. Do you observe? Ah, that's where the x to 6 came from. That's where it came from. So then now you can just look back at the previous exercise. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to just do a bunch of these. Okay, we're going to have to figure out the integrating factor and then carry out the whole procedure. Okay? So any question about it before we do that? Any question about this? Okay? Wish him the best of luck. Okay. So, how about dy dx plus 2xy Minus x is equal to 0. Okay, and I'd like you to solve it using an integrating factor. Yeah, I think that's a concrete drill, a concrete hammer drill.
But you have patience because you have kids.
Yeah. Well, also my family's in construction, and I've used that machine myself.
They've been working on my work building for the past year that I've been there, so.
There you go. All right. So what do you think? Is this a linear first order differential equation?
Yeah.
If it is, then you should be able to arrange it in this way and tell me what P and Q are. So first off, is it already in this format?
No.
No, it's just barely not, right? Okay, so now it's in that format. What is P?
2x.
Right, so P of x is 2x. And Q of x
is x.
Okay, so then, what is the formula in terms of P for the integrating factor?
I of x equals E to the integer root of 2x dx.
Yes. So it's always the exponential of the antiderivative of P of x. Okay, so one of the things I'm gonna do tonight is I'm gonna say that as many times as possible. good one. Yeah, I like that. Good. Okay, so this is exponential antiderivative 2x dx. So do we know the antiderivative of 2x?
Yes.
Yes, what is it?
x squared,
good. Okay, so now we have the integrating factor. So what did we do with the integrating factor the first time? Multiplied the whole thing.
Oh, so e to x squared can be the integrating factor.
Is the integrating factor.
Yes. Okay.
So e to x squared.
To put it back.
Dy dx.
Wait,
plus e to x squared. 2xy. Is e to x squared. Times x. And notably, the left-hand side is by design of the integrating factor. By design.
Oh,
a product rule.
Oh, yeah.
Of,
I see that now.
And what is it? What goes in there? So I'll give you a hint. It is always and every time I of x multiplied by y. So every time.
Oh, so e to x squared y?
Yes.
I don't think I understand.
Well, the reason why is that it's that way by design.
That's the whole purpose of doing it.
That's the whole purpose of doing it.
So like, I don't really necessarily need to know how to get there, I just need to acknowledge that it's I times y.
Okay, yeah, I suppose you could take that strategy.
That will make him happy.
Well, the problem with that is that you know, if you don't really have an understanding, and then you do something, and I'll say it like this. You know, I know a stock list of phrases in a variety of languages. Okay, so I could go somewhere, you know, and probably not die because I could find food and the bathroom. Okay, but using those stock phrases in a weird way, right, that's not going to work, right?
So I guess my question is then, can you show me how you got
yes
to I?
So have a look at this.
I'm looking.
So e to x squared, that's a function of x, and y is a function of x implicitly.
Right.
So if we were to differentiate this product, we would need to use the product rule. Right?
Okay.
So where there's two factors. This term right here is the first factor times the derivative of the second. And this term is the second factor multiplied by the derivative of the first. The derivative of e to x squared is e to x squared times 2x.
Right.
This, so what I'm, what the, I think the reason for the confusion is that you are accustomed to going this direction. And I'm asking you to do it in the other direction.
Just like that antiderivative.
Just like, yeah, same thing. Okay, so now what can we do from here?
Do the antiderivative.
Not quite. We need one more thing.
Hold on. Multiply the dx.
Yes. So the differential of e to x squared y is e to x squared x dx. So we performed a separation in this way. We separated the differentials. So now what can we do from here?
Antiderivative.
Now antidifferentiate. So the left-hand side is, on the one hand, a little tricky, but on the other hand, obvious. So what is it?
E to x squared y.
E to x squared y. Because you have antiderivative of differential of this thing. So whatever I'm hiding under my finger there, it has to come right back out, so that thing. So now, I'll just copy this first. So now we want to do this. How will we do this? No?
I forgot. Interchain rule?
We could. I don't think by parts would work, actually.
U substitution.
A U substitution. Right. What will we do?
U is
x squared. Very good. So a U substitution. So I'll just copy this. So e to x squared y is antiderivative e to x squared x dx. So then u is x squared, so du is 2x dx, and then, oh no, we don't have 2x dx.
That's okay.
We'll just give up. Right?
Go home.
go home.
We'll just divide du by 2.
Okay, so du over 2 is x dx. So e to x squared y is antiderivative e to u du over 2 Now that over two is just, can be factored out as half, and then do we know antiderivative of e to u du?
Mm-hmm.
It's e to u. So this would be e to x squared y is half, and then e to u, but we said u was x squared, so e to x squared.
Plus c.
And then plus a constant. And now, on questions like this, I'll say solve for y. So what does that mean?
Divide each side by.
Okay, good. So if we divide both sides, if we divide both sides by e to x squared, then when we do that, this e to x squared will be canceled. So this will be half. And then plus c over. Right. And then typically, for exponential terms, you don't write it like this. Instead, you put it in the numerator. But to put it in the numerator, what do you need to do?
Negate the exponent.
So this would be y is half, and then plus c exponential negative x squared. They're all as fun as this. Again, this, you know, this is an important skill, I guess. It helps you learn how to, you know, formulate a plan and carry out a complicated list of instructions. But to be honest with you, this is incredibly boring to me.
Really,
to do this.
Can you just look at it and see it? Well, you did with this x to the 6 earlier.
By this time, I can come up with a solution with significantly less steps than what I show. But that's me, right? And that's not what I'm trying to do here. I'm trying to teach. But still, the fact that this is so just a, like, turn the crank calculation, like, oh, and the next thing we do is that we divide. It's really boring to me. I like pictures better. Okay.
So we're gonna draw one now?
No, we're gonna do more of these. Because the state of Texas thinks this is an important skill. So we're going to do it.
Which is the University of Texas?
Yes, but exactly. At the University of Texas at Austin, you don't have to take Texas for a business degree.
At UT.
Really?
At UT Austin, you do not.
Believe it or not, to a large degree, the curriculum of courses is defined by statute, believe it or not. So if you don't like it, you're going to have to vote.
But okay. Now what's required for the degree isn't. However, what's being taught in the course is.
More or less, yeah. So 2 dy dx minus 6y minus e to x equal to 0 is the differential equation. And it is known that xy equal to 0, 5 is a solution. So this last clause is new for today. So this means that you're going to have to figure out what c is. That's what that means. So formerly, you were just finding the general solution. We weren't trying to determine what C is. This is saying you have to figure out what C is.
So.
Yes?
Never mind. We'll work through it.
Okay. So we have two major ways to solve differential equations now. If the differential equation I give you happens to be separable, then you can separate and anti-differentiate. That will work. If it's not separable, then you only have one other way in the world, in this class, to proceed. How do you proceed? With an integrating factor. So it's good for you to know that, because I'm just going to give you differential equations, and I may not tell you, you know, this one is separable or it's not. So in some cases, you know, it may, one technique may be better than the other. So is this separable? Is there some way you can get all the x's on one side, x's and dx's on one side, and all the y's and dy's on the other side? Okay, so then try and separate it.
So it can't be 2 dy minus 6y equals e to the x dx?
So let me see if I take your meaning. So I'm gonna check for separability. So 2 dy dx minus 6y, and I think I understood that you said you put the e to the x on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then I multiply the dx.
Okay, and I'm going to write something that I think you might have written.
Actually, I didn't write it that way. I did it the other way.
Okay, I think you might have imagined this.
I did imagine this. That's okay. Exactly what I imagined.
Okay.
Except for now I realize that 6y would have had the dx on it.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, so first off, there's a lot of things not good with this. So one thing that's good is that the x's and the y's are now separated. But the thing that's bad is that this, as you say, is missing a dx. Okay, so you're missing that. Okay. So that's not going to work.
I'm going to file this one under. Does not exist. Yeah.
Okay, so the important thing here is, you know, just always write something down, because it's easier to confirm or deny something if it's written down. So no, it's not separable. So if it's not separable, then there's only one way to proceed, and what's that? With an integrating factor. Okay, so what's P of x?
-6.
No?
Oh, what? I'm sorry.
Oh.
What is it?
Is it -3?
What's P of x?
Is it -3?
Yes.
Oh.
Because remember that that our definition of a linear first order differential equation looks like this. And to be a little over the top, or to really emphasize what I'm talking about, I'm going to write a 1 here. Okay, so in what way is the given differential equation not currently in the pattern that we need? That 2, right? That 2 is messing us up. So to get it right, we're going to need to divide by 2.
That's the only problem?
More or less, and we've got to get this on the other side. So then 2 dy dx minus 6y is e to x. So then dy dx minus 3y is half e to x. And then maybe to be really over the top, plus -3y half e to x. Okay, so then what is P of x?
-3.
And yes, it's just fine when P of x is a constant function. That's one of the easiest cases. It doesn't need to be a constant function, but when it is, you know, terrific. So, what is the formula for the integrating factor? The exponential of of the antiderivative of P of X. So I'm gonna write down this formula as many times as I can today and say it out loud as many times as I can today. So that'll be exponential of antiderivative of negative 3 dx. Okay, so then what's the antiderivative of negative 3 dx? Negative 3x, and we don't need the plus c at this position. So the integrating factor is exponential of negative 3x. Any question about determining the integrating factor? What do we do with the integrating factor? So what do we do with it? I'm not sure I follow.
What do we do with the integrating? We multiply the entire equation.
Right. It's called an integrating factor. Factor means part of a multiplication. So what you're going to do is you take the original, you take this, not the original one, but this one that's been put in the right format. You take this differential equation and you multiply it by the integrating factor. So then e to negative 3x dy dx plus e to negative 3x times negative 3 y is half e to x e to negative 3x. Okay, so now the left hand side is purpose built, designed. How can we simplify the left hand side?
D over dx to e to the negative 3x.
Almost.
Why?
There it is. All right, the left-hand side is a product rule. Is the result of a product rule.
Is it always the product rule?
It is always this. It's always going to be. This is always going to be I of x. And that's always going to be y. It is always going to be the derivative of product of I of x and y. By design. Okay, then the right-hand side of this equation can be simplified a little bit. So that half is good to go. And then these exponentials can be combined. How can they be combined?
Oh, it's negative 2x.
Right. Because the bases are the same, the exponents can be added. And so now we can take this dx and move it to the other side. And what now? Right. Through the magic of the product rule, we were able to separate the differentials in this way. Okay. So the antiderivative of both sides . Okay, again, this is antiderivative and differential just cancel. And then the right-hand side, that would be exponential negative 2x
over
negative 2, yes. And then plus a constant. So we can perform a little bit of simplification now. So let's do it. So e to negative 3x y is negative 1/4 exponential negative 2x plus c. And then I guess we'll go ahead and solve for y. What do we need to do to solve for y?
Divide both sides by e to the negative 3x.
Very good. And dividing by e to negative 3x is the same as multiplying by what?
3x.
E to positive 3x.
Yeah.
Right. So this would be y is negative 1/4 e to negative 2x e to 3x
plus
c e to 3x. And then these can be combined. So to just e to x, very good. So y is negative 1/4.
Ooh, I forgot my negative.
E to x plus c e to 3x. And surely this is the answer.
No.
No.
Plug it in.
Why is this not the answer?
Because we have to, you give us the answer. It's not the general solution. We
right.
Have to find c.
Right, we need to determine c. So we're going to take this information now that we've been holding on to. We're going to put it in there now. So when we plug in x is 0, we're supposed to get y is 5. So 5 is negative 1/4. And then e to 0, that's 1, plus c, and then e to 0, that's 1. So moving the negative 4th over, this is 20/4 plus another 4th, so that's 21 of them. So the answer is y is negative 1/4 e to x plus 21 over 4 e to 3x. Terrific. They're all like this.
Oh my God.
Every one of them is this way. It's just a grind.
Is there something wrong with you?
No. It takes all kinds.
There's a lot of algebra involved, and I like algebra. So.
Well, that's fine. That's just, you're just, that's that style. I don't care for it. I like pictures. I prefer pictures anyway. That's not to say that this isn't important. This is incredibly important as a technique. Yeah.
Are we going to have to graph those? Like,
not really.
Okay. Can you graph them?
Yes. Plotting. Plotting certain aspects of differential equations is a very important thing, but it's not covered in this class. Okay. So maybe we'll get off of these abstract ones for a minute, and we might come back. Let's do some applications of differential equations. So do you have this now? Okay. So this is section 10.4. Applications. Has a T next. Of differential equations. So we're going to go through a few different real world scenarios, word problem type things. And since the primary consumer of this class is the business school, I guess the first one we'll do is money. We'll do some money problem. So we're going to do a word problem. And, this is a remark first. We're going to do a word problem. And we've kind of already visited this a little bit. but we were looking at it from a different point of view. So we're going to look at it now from the point of view of differential equations. So suppose that we have a bank account. So an account with balance A and annual interest rate R. So if you have an account with balance A and annual interest rate R, then that means that because of the interest rate, the balance is changing in time. It's changing in time. And furthermore, because of the way interest rates work, when you have a small balance in your account, then that means that the interest deposits are small. And when you have a big balance in your account, that means that the interest payments are big, right? So you know, Bill Gates with his $60 billion bank account, his interest payments are probably, you know, a lot. Okay, whereas I get significantly less, right? His interest payments for his $60 billion account is probably more than the present balance of my account. Okay, terrific. Okay, so that means that we know something about a differential equation that relates these. So the rate of change, dA dt, of the account balance, A. So generally speaking, rate of change means time derivative. So if x is position, what's the rate of change of position? Dx dt. Okay, if volume is V, then what's the rate of change of volume? dV dt. If height is h, what's the rate of change of height? dH dt. What's the rate of change of banana? D banana dt, right? Okay, good. It's always d whatever dt. Okay, so the rate of change of the account balance, dA dt, is proportional to the current balance. So that means it should just be RA. When you have a small balance, you get small interest payments. When you have a big balance, big interest payments. Okay. So if, in addition further, if deposits D are also made, so that is to say, deposits that are not related to interest, then what will dA dt be? So it'll still be RA. We'll still get the balance changing because of interest reckoning. But what else? We'll also get plus D, right? So this is your account balance is changing because of two factors. One of them is the interest that's being reckoned against your account. And then the other one is the deposits being made. So this is really pretty realistic scenario. For a bank account. So here's a differential equation. Let's solve a word problem using this differential equation. So to be a little self-serving, future UTD student is born. And at this time, relative deposits some nice big amount. So what's a nice amount for them to deposit?
$1,000.
Okay. Deposits $1,000 into a, say, 5% annual interest rate account. And then every year deposits another nice amount. So what is that going to be?
500.
And deposits, and then now I have to say continuously. At a rate of 500 per year. Okay, so what I mean by that is this is a place where because this is a calculus course, we're kind of realistic but not. So what this means is that at every instant, relative is depositing money, and over the course of a year, it's 500. So it's coming in at a constant rate. Okay, so a constant rate of 500 per year, and then find the account balance at 18 years when they're ready to go to UTV. And then I want you to do this using the differential equation above. Okay, so let's try and extract what we know from the story. So, future student is born and a relative deposits $1,000. So there's a number. So apparently that's something. So let's try and write down all the things that we know. So here's a number, 1,000. What does that tell us?
No, that's A.
A is a function. So let me rephrase a little bit. So we have 1,000 here. When is it 1,000? When is it 1,000?
At year zero.
At year zero. So what we know is that T, comma A equal to 0, 1,000 is a solution. That's what we know, is part of it. So what's that gonna, because we're solving a differential equation, what does that give us? That's gonna let us determine the unknown constant, right? So we always use this information to determine the unknown constant. So there's gonna be, because we're solving a differential equation, an unknown constant's gonna show up. This is gonna tell us what it is. Okay, here's another number, 5%. What does that tell us?
R.
Tells us R, so what is R?
0.05.
Okay, good, 0.05. Okay, blah, 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 continuously. Okay, so 500.
D.
So that's D. And then blah, 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 blah. Okay, 18. What are we going to do with 18?
The number of $500 deposits there are.
Well, so the story is that it's being deposited continuously. So there aren't any such $500 deposits. It's like,
so 9,000 total.
Right, but it would be like fractions of pennies are being wired to the account at every instant. It has to be this way, otherwise it's not a calculus question. Okay, so then what are we going to do with this 18? Yeah, is we're going to solve the differential equation, and then what? And then plug in 18.
That'll be our constant?
No, that won't be the constant. It'll be, we'll solve the differential equation, and then we'll plug in 18.
You'll have to show me. I don't
know. Okay. Okay, so is there any question about extracting these bits of information from the story? Okay, because once they're extracted, then it's just differential equation from there. Okay. So the differential equation is dA dt is 0.05 A plus 500. Okay, so that's the differential equation. Okay, now before we even get any further, let's make sure that we have a reasonable answer for what's going to happen. So if we ignore interest altogether, how much money is the relative depositing altogether?
10,000.
Is it 10,000? So 1,000 initially, and then 500 a year for 18 years, which is 10,000, right? Because it's this 1,000, and the 500 a year for 18 years is 9, so 10,000 altogether. Whatever your answer is,
it should be more than 10,000.
It must be more than 10,000. So if you solve this question,
and then
they
could pay for one semester at school.
Yeah. If you solve this question and what you say is that, and you say that the number is less than 10,000, then first off, you've made a mistake. And more than that, it's wrong, but in a big way. It means that you've like totally missed the connection between the mathematics and the problem and the real world. Okay? So it's not a little mistake. It's a big one. Okay. So here's a differential equation. Let's solve it. So we have two methods to solve. If it's separable, we use that way. If it's not, then we can use an integrating factor. So is it separable?
No.
Yes, it's separable. So it can be separated. So notice that on the right-hand side, there's no t's. So what are the variables, by the way? A's and t's, right? The right-hand side has no t's. So we could divide by the whole right-hand side and then multiply by dt. And the variables will be separated. Now that they're separated, what? What do you do once you've got them separated?
Take the
antiderivative. Okay, the right-hand side's easy, it's t. The left-hand side, so I'm hoping that by now at this position in the semester you can see, okay, I'm gonna need to do a substitution.
U sub.
And when you do that, you're gonna say u is the denominator, and then you're gonna have a constant floating around, and it's gonna, in the end, be some constant multiple of 1 over u du, right? So what's that gonna be? What is the antiderivative of 1 over u du? Log, absolute value, right? So then hopefully, I hope by now, it'll be all right if I skip that and write this, and if it's not, then by all means, continue doing the substitution yourself. Okay, now what? Yeah, now we can figure out what C is. We can figure out what C is because we know a value of T and A. So furthermore, I'm going to drop the absolute value. Why am I going to drop the absolute value? Because in this story, the account balance is always positive. Under no circumstance is it negative. So drop the absolute value. So now we can determine C. So that'd be 1 divided by 0.05 log of 0.05 times 1,000 plus 500 is 0 plus C. So we could type that into the calculator. So I'm getting 126-ish. Mm-hmm. Do we have agreement? Okay. So 126.198. And because we're gonna keep using this number, I'm gonna not round until the end. Okay, so that's our number for C. I'm not going to round much, right? So that is rounded, but that has lots of digits. Okay. So now the equation that we have is 1 divided by 0.05 log 0.05a plus 500. Is T plus 126.198 3656. Okay, now what? What do we do from here? What is it that we were trying to figure out?
What the value will be at age 18.
What the value will be at age 18. So what are we supposed to do?
We plug in 18 for T.
Yeah, so now we need to figure out, we need to plug in 18 for T and then solve for A. So now plug in T is 18. So 1 over 0.05 log of 0.05a plus 500 is, so that number plus 18. One ninety-eight, three six five six. Okay, we want to solve for A, so what next? Yeah. Yes. Multiply by 0.05, so that would be log 0.05a plus 500 is 7.2099182 78. Now what? Exponential. So that would be 1352. Point 781711. And then minus 500 divide by 0.05. Okay, so I'm getting 170.55, and now finally we can round to the nearest cent, 63. Okay, right. So more than 10,000 was the remark. So why is it important that it's more than 10,000? Yeah, it means that at least you're in the realm of reasonableness, right? So how much money left the hand of the relative? $10,000. And it's going into an account that has a 5% interest. So it should be more than 10,000. Okay. This one? This is, I exponentiated this. Other questions? Okay. So, well, yeah, not really. You gotta have a couple relatives pitching in, right? Okay. So now let's do another problem, but let's make it more interesting. So, hopefully everyone has fond memories of being a child or even presently has a child. So maybe you remember yourself or your child doing something like the following. They're in the bathtub, okay, in the bathtub, and they are running the water, and the plug is open. And you go in there, and they either say to you or you say to them, "Why are you running the bathtub with the plug open?" You do realize you're just pouring money down the drain. Everybody's heard that, I think, probably. Okay, so now, we've got a tub, okay, and water's coming in and water's going out. Okay, what would be the necessary condition so that the water level in the tub would be going up overall?
Water coming in would have to be going in faster than the water going out.
Right. So whatever water's coming out of the faucet must be more than what's going through the drain. In such a case, the water level will rise. And then to make the water level go down, it has to be reversed. Whatever's coming out of the faucet just must be less whatever's going through the drain. And for it to be stable, they must be the same. Okay? So now let's make it more interesting. Let's say that, okay, currently the stopper is in, the faucet is off, but there's water in the tub, and then someone comes by and puts a bunch of food coloring in it. So now it's all colored water. Okay, then right when you do that, you open up the stopper, you turn on the water, and so now water is, and you're mixing it, right? Because there's a child in there who's excited about there being colored water. Okay, so then water's leaving, water's coming in. What will happen to the food coloring, to the color of the water as you proceed?
No light.
Yeah.
Depends on the rate, right?
Yes and no, right? As long as the bathtub's not overflowing, so let's assume that never happens. Mm-hmm. As long as water is leaving, then over time, the concentration of the food coloring is going down. So if you were to run this experiment long enough, eventually the coloring of the water would be to the unable to measure anymore. It'd be clear. Okay? So you run the experiment long enough. Okay. Now let's change the situation a little bit. Let's change the situation. What if the bathtub is full, you know, or has water in it and it's clear water? And now we've rigged the faucet so it pours out colored water. Okay, so then we open up the plug and out and turn on the faucet, out comes the colored water, and we're mixing it up. So what's going to happen over time?
Darker.
Yeah, it's going to get, eventually, if you run the experiment long enough, the color of the water in the tub will be the same as the color as the water coming out. You run the experiment long enough. Okay, and then you can do anything you want, like, you know, multiple colors, multiple holes, multiple faucets,
wow,
all kinds of stuff. Right? Okay, so these are called mixture problems. Okay, so we've got concentrations, volumes, solutions, particles coming in, particles going out. So
other than bathtub, what's the practical application?
Okay, well. Yeah, so you could, in chemistry, you could do things like you want to maintain. Here's one. In order for you to survive, okay, you have to maintain a certain blood chemistry, solute levels in your blood, and your body is literally doing this. It's literally solving a differential equation to keep the levels right. Okay, little protein pumps pumping out sodium molecules and pumping in potassium molecules to make the concentrations right. So more down to earth, maybe, or at least larger, is that you know, most people overlook the sewage treatment in major cities. Are you aware that in DFW there's like 6.5 million people? That's a lot of showers and toilet flushes. A lot, right? Where does it all go? Most people have no idea. Okay, it's just magic. It's just down the drain, and then where does the water come from? Wow, I've got the water leaving. The water that I don't want is leaving, and the water that I do want is coming in. Where's it all happening? Well, there's places, okay, where you take all the water that you don't want, the sewage water. And then you have to get the sewage out, okay? And believe it or not, the clean water is then put back into the drinking water. Okay, that's the way it is. So all that you really needed to do, okay, is get it clean enough for human consumption. Okay, and there are literally people who concern themselves with the differential equations for the treatment of sewage and then the designing and construction of such machines so that we can live in polite society with bathrooms and faucets. Okay, so it's a real thing. So let's solve one. Except the way the book does it, the book always says salt. That's so boring. Waters and colors and sewage. No, we'll just stick with salt. Okay. So generally speaking, this is the model, is that you've got a tank. You you've got a tank, and it's got a little exit, and then you've got, you know, a faucet or whatever coming into the tank. You got water in there, and now mixture water is coming out. Okay, and in the tank is some kind of propeller that always keeps it perfectly mixed. Okay, that's a little propeller, and it's spinning around, mixing it all up. You know what I mean? It's like a blender. Okay, and then you've got water coming in. So you've got stuff coming in. So at every moment, you've got a volume. What's the current volume of the tank? So we've got volume. So dV/dt will always be the volume that's going in. So volume rate in minus the volume rate out. So, for example, if we were doing the bathtub thing and the bathtub was able to drain 3 gallons per minute, which isn't much, but okay, whatever, it's able to drain 3 gallons per minute, and then the faucet is putting out, say, 5 gallons per minute. So 5 gallons per minute is coming out of the faucet. 3 gallons per minute is going through the drain. So altogether, how is the volume changing? It's 2 gallons per minute. Positive, right? Means the water level's going up. So you get 2 more gallons because 5's coming in, 3's going out. That's a net of 2. Similarly, so 5 in, 3 out, a net of 2. Alternately, we could say, well, the drain is able to drain 10 gallons a minute and the faucet's doing 3 gallons per minute. So that's a net of -7. The water is draining. Okay? So volume is related like this. Then, typically, you have some kind of concentration. Of salt. So salt is just a word for, it means anything. It could be food coloring, it could be whatever. Okay, the concentration of salt is S over V, where salt is the amount of salt and V is the volume presently in the tank. So if this is the concentration, if this is the concentration of salt in the tank, so this is concentration of salt in the tank. Then how much salt, if this is pouring out, then how much salt is leaving the tank at any given time? How much salt is leaving the tank at any given time? So let's think about it for a minute. What if we have a solution that has, we've dissolved salt into water, and presently it is 1 pound per gallon. That's totally unreasonable, but let's just say that. 1 pound per gallon. And if 3 gallons per minute are leaving, then how much salt?
3 pounds.
3 pounds is leaving, right? Because there's 1 pound per gallon, and 3 gallons are leaving, so 3 pounds of salt are leaving. So how much salt is leaving the tank at any given time? It's the concentration multiplied by the volume leaving the tank. So if it's 1 pound for every 10 gallons, and if 5 gallons are leaving, then half a pound is leaving. Okay, so let's have an exercise. Now that we've sort of talked about it abstractly. So I'll read it out loud, and then I'll write down the important parts. So suppose the tank contains 100 gallons of a solution of salt and water, and it's kept stirred, so it's instantly stirred. Okay. If pure water is allowed to flow into the tank and the mixture flows out of the tank, then how much salt is there after so much time? Okay, so you start out with some salty water, pure water is pouring in. How much salt is in the tank as a function of time? Okay, so we've got a tank. The story says that we have 100 gallons of solution. So that tells us something about the initial volume. So what does that tell us? We start out with 100 gallons. So what does that say? It says that T comma V equal to 0, 100 is one of the points of the solution. Okay. Pure water flows into the tank at a rate of 4 gallons per minute. So this is pure water. And mixture water is leaving at a rate of 3 gallons per minute. So already you should be able to tell me about the volume in the tank as a function of time. Yeah, should be going up by 1 gallon per minute. Okay, and this tank, you know, for the purposes of this story, is enormous, vastly bigger than we're ever going to have to worry about it overflowing or something like that. So that's not a concern. Okay, the next thing that we're told is that the initial amount of salt is 15 pounds. So what does that tell us? What's another one of the points of the solution? It tells us that TS, if S is the amount of salt, is 0.15, is one of the solutions, one of the point solutions. Okay. So let's see if we can get this figured out. So the amount of salt is changing as a function of time. So ds dt. That is the salt coming in. Minus the salt going out. Well, how much salt is coming in?
Zero.
Zero, right? So that would be zero. Okay. Whoops. This should say out. So how do we know that no salt is coming in? Yeah, it says pure water is coming in. Okay, so no salt. Okay, now, how much salt is coming out? Well, you can't use 100. You can't use 100 because the volume is changing, right? So we need to use V. So this would be negative S over V, that's the current concentration. But that's concentration, that's not how much salt is leaving. So how do you find how much salt is leaving the tank? Times 3 gallons per minute, because it's the current concentration. How much is leaving is the concentration multiplied by the flow rate. So this would be multiplied by 3. So here we have a differential equation. ds dt is negative 3s divided by v. And this is a bit of a problem, okay, that we will overcome, but there's a problem here. Is that the differential equations, because the left-hand side is ds dt, we need to have only s's and t's, right? But we have v, and v is not a constant. So we need to figure out what v is. We need to figure out a formula for v. Okay, so what do we know? We know that dv dt, well, that's the volume rate coming in minus the volume rate going out. Do we know both of those? One, so that'd be 4 minus 3 is 1. So here's a differential equation. This is a good one, right? dv dt is 1. I like that one. So dv is dt. So v is t plus a constant. How do we figure out the constant? Yeah, the same way we always do. We take a known point and plug it in. So when you plug in t is 0 and v is 100, that's supposed to be a solution. So that tells us what c is. What is c then? C is 100. So that tells us the formula for v. It's t plus 100. Now, I'd like to point out that that's kind of obvious now, isn't it? Now that it's written down. The volume started out at 100. The flow rate in is 4. The flow rate out is 3. So,
sure.
So every minute, one more gallon is coming in.
It wasn't that obvious.
It's not obvious?
No.
Okay.
Sorry.
So now we can take this V. Now we can take this V and put it into this differential equation, which is the one that we actually wanted to solve. So ds dt is negative 3s over t plus 100. Okay, now do we have the right number of variables?
Yes.
Yes, we have S's and T's only. That's great. So, finally, we've come to a differential equation. Is it separable, or do we need to use an integrating factor? So, it's not a matter of guessing.
Oh, I realize that, but my intuition is always wrong on this one. So I should take whatever I think and go the other way.
What do you think? So it's separable.
See, that was exactly the opposite of what I was thinking. So.
Now could you use? An integrating factor?
Yes.
Yes. You could. Do you want to do it that way?
No, not if we don't have to.
It might even be easier to do it that way.
Sometimes.
I don't have any preference. So it just needs to be solved one way or the other. So what do we do on the last one?
It was separable.
It was separable. So we did it that way. So
I want to know why this is separable. Can you show me that? Because I really don't see that.
Okay, so
I guess that's where I'm struggling, because the last time I didn't see it either. So.
Okay, do you observe that S's and T's are on the left?
Yes.
And S's and T's are on the right?
Yes.
So at the present position, it's not separated?
Correct.
Okay, so then now, this is a product. It's a quotient, but same difference. Okay, so the fact that it's all like this means that we're going to be able to cross multiply and do things.
There's no addition or subtraction.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So that makes sense now.
I could take this ds and say that this is negative 3s over t plus 100 dt. So I move the dt over. Is it separated now?
No.
No, not yet. So I could divide by s. And get 1 over s ds is negative 3 over t plus 100 dt.
Well, let's just do it this way since we're good.
I don't know. So y'all probably need to see another integrating factor, right?
Probably.
So let's do that. So do you observe that it's separated? You could definitely solve it from here. Okay, but just to be, you know, because this is lecture, let's do it by an integrating factor just for whimsy. Whimsy. Have you seen those shows, those decorating shows? They always use that word, whimsy. Okay. So for no good reason, let's use an integrating factor. So if we're going to do that, then we need to write this in the standard form. That is ds dt plus 3 over t plus 100 s is equal to 0. So I took this equation, I moved it to the other side, okay, and then factored it out. So what is Q of T?
Zero.
Yes. So this is Q of T. And what is P of T? Yes, this. Oh, it's going to be shorter. It's going to be easy. It's going to be great. And so what's I of t then? Exponential of antiderivative of p of t dt. Okay. So then I of t is exponential of antiderivative of 3 over t plus 100 dt. Okay, and this is going to be great because look, so this is an antiderivative that you know, right, more or less. You could do a really minor substitution. What is this? Three, and then what? Log t plus 100. Now I'm omitting the absolute value. Why am I doing that? Right, because we started at time zero, and we're not worried about what happened before we started. So that's never negative. So now I want to simplify this expression, but that three is in the way. So how can we get the three out of the way? Put it inside of the log. How does this three in front get inside? Becomes an exponent. So this is exponential of log of t plus 100 cubed, like that. And so how does this simplify now? T plus 100 cubed. Sorry?
I thought maybe I don't make sense. I'm saying it loud enough.
Okay. So.
I do. I want to be a math major now.
Want to be a math major? All right. Okay.
School quickly.
So, multiplying the integrating factor through, that would give us that d dt of t plus 100 cubed multiplied by s is 0. Look at that. That's nice. So we multiplied it by both sides. Okay. So then what do we do from here? Right. So we d t plus 100 cubed s is 0 dt. So then antiderivative, so t plus 100 cubed s is, what's the antiderivative of 0 dt?
0?
No.
T? No, I have no idea.
What kind of thing? What kind of thing has a derivative of zero?
A constant.
A constant. So just a constant. And we can't use C. Why can't we not use C? Because we already used a C, right? Okay, so then that's K. How do we figure out what K is? Yeah, I'm not sure what happened there. Tired, I'm sure. Yes, back at the top.
Otherwise, we wouldn't have gotten this.
Yeah, we wouldn't have gotten here. Okay, so now we're going to determine. So we're going to determine k. The thing that we know is that, 0 and 15. So that's saying that, 0, 100 cubed times 15 is k. And so now we can solve for s and get that s is 100 cubed times 15, that's k, and then divided by t plus 100 cubed. Beautiful. So
wait.
I did two things at the same time. I did s is k over the thing.
Oh,
and
okay.
I plugged in k.
Okay. Are you putting these notes online
tonight?
Tomorrow?
Yeah, I'll do it tomorrow. Okay, so now. as a follow-up question.
Why would we not solve for k, or you just don't care to find that, what that number is?
I did find k. So I said s is k over that.
Okay.
K over that.
Okay.
Okay. So what is the amount of salt? The amount of salt at, say, t is 25 minutes. So what do you have to do to figure that out?
Plug 25 in for t.
Right, so let's do that real quick.
25 minutes is just something that you just know.
I just threw that out there. Okay, now what does this really need to be less than? Let's think about this for a minute. So we started out with 100 gallons and 15 pounds of salt. And clean water, pure water's flowing in, mixture water's flowing out. So when you plug this into your calculator, it surely must be less than what? 15. Must be less than 15. If you give me an answer that's more than 15, you're saying that as a result of having 15 pounds at the beginning, pouring in pure water and mixture water pouring out, I now have more salt than I began with. Okay, that's what you would be saying if you gave me an answer more than 15. So I get 7.68. Mm-hmm. Now I have a question for you. Besides that one check, let's look at this. What do you suspect from reading the physical description of the problem? What should happen to the amount of salt as time goes on? It should decrease all the way to zero. Maybe not all the way to zero, but in the limit, it should be zero. Okay, is that going to be true of this? Is the limit of S zero as T goes to infinity?
Yes,
it is, because this is a constant, and this is a thing that's going to get arbitrarily big. The denominator will get arbitrarily big, so its limit is zero. Okay, now, if I give you a different question, you know, where it's like, okay, you start out with a very high concentration of salt in your tub, and then it's draining out. And then the faucet is pouring in a lesser concentration of salt, not zero, not pure water, but a lesser concentration. As time goes to infinity, what should happen to the concentration in the tub? It should become the same as whatever's coming out of the faucet, right? So that's like saying, okay, imagine that you have a bathtub that has no food coloring in it, clear water, and then but you've got a faucet, and this faucet is pouring out food colored water. Then you've got faucet water coming in, colored faucet water coming in. You've got it's mixed up, water's draining out. After you run this experiment long enough, how will the bath look? The same as the water coming out of the faucet. This is better than money? Okay, well, there you go. It's just different people like different things. But we could do it with could I make it like this for a bank account? Yeah, we could do things like, okay, so suppose you have money coming in and money going out, and
that's more realistic for a bank account.
Yeah, maybe I'll make one of those tomorrow. It'll be fun. Okay, so that's all that I have for today.
Wow.
Okay, so have a nice weekend.